I would like to tell you a very important aspect of the Buddha's teaching that he has advised us to contemplate or to think always in our day-to-day life. Because many of our worries, disappointment, frustrations, unhappiness, we maintain due to lack of concentration of these kind of advices given by the Buddha. We create our own imagination when the thing goes against our wish or our will, then we worry. This is our weakness. Therefore, we had to train our mind to face certain problems which we don't like, but no other choice. We had to train ourselves to face. At the same time, we had to train our mind to overcome certain problems that we are facing. And also we had to train our mind to avoid from certain problems that we had to face. This is the method. Not by worrying or crying or complaining or accusing or blaming, but by training our own mind. There are 5 advices given by the Buddha for us to think almost every day. They are not very pleasant, very soothing subjects, but natural. When we use our mind to face the nature, natural occurrences, then we don't worry. Then what are these 5? Jara dhammom hi jarang anatito ti abhinhang paccavekkhitabbam. When we are young, we have to think our youth or our beauty or complexion never remain forever without changing. This beauty, this complexion, this youth, subject to change. Therefore, slowly, slowly, we are going on decaying and decaying and decaying and decaying. There is nobody in this world who can stop this. Whatever precaution we take, there is no method for us to stop. So if there is no method for us to escape, our duty is to train the mind to face when such situation take place. We have to think this again and again and again. After that, later, when we grow old, we don't worry. Because we knew this, we train our mind knowing that old age come to us and we have to face it. So without worrying, we face it, we take it. This is the first advice. Second advice is, Vyadhi dhammom hi vyadhin anatito ti abhinhang paccavekkhitabba. Although I am healthy, but life is uncertain. Changes can take place at any time. Sicknesses may appear at any time. There is no age limit for sicknesses, whether we are young or old. Because the formations of this physical body is such that the elements and the energies that function in this body, there will be a lot of imbalance, disagreement, clashes, and then the sicknesses appear. That is the uncertainty in our physical body. Even the Arahantas and the Buddhas, physical body is also not free from old age and sicknesses. The Buddha had to face 12 kinds of sicknesses. Some of them were very serious. Finally, he passed away at the age of 80 because of severe stomach complaint. Could not stop it. If the Buddha's physical body is such, because his mind is so pure, so holy, so enlightened, even then the body is not holy, not enlightened, not sacred. The body is subject to old age and sicknesses. When he was about 8 years old, he showed his physical body to his disciples. Look at my body now. You have seen me for the last 30 to 40 years. At that time you have seen the golden color, complexion in my skin, my body. And look at my body now. Wrinkle all over my body. Then he said, my body is just like a rotten bullock cart, because those days no motor cars. So he used worn out bullock cart, very difficult to move. He says, I am very tired. I want to sit down. I am thirsty. I want to drink some water. This is the physical body of the Buddha. So what about us? So we have to think, no one is free from old age and sicknesses. We cannot choose sicknesses. It depends on the elements, the energies of the physical body. At the same time, mind also creates so many sicknesses. More sicknesses created by the mind, not by the element. When we maintain some sort of frustration, worries, fear, tension, suspicion, insecurity feeling, these mental forces later turn into some sicknesses, either in the brain cells, or in the nervous system, or in the glands, or in the blood circulation, or various organs of the body, or the stomach, immediately create some sicknesses. So when we maintain healthy mind without taking things so seriously into our mind, we can avoid certain sicknesses. But in the case of the Buddhas and Arahantas, their sicknesses were not created by the mind, only physical disorder. At the same time, the Buddha also mentioned, Kamma vipakaja abadha. We had to suffer from certain sicknesses due to certain bad deeds that we have committed during our previous birth. The Buddha had to face them. He pointed out. He explained to his disciples what he has done during some of his previous births. And today he says he is suffering from this particular sickness because of that bad deed that I have committed long ago. So do you think you are free from all those things? And we do not know what kind of bad deed that we have committed during our previous birth, but not yet paid. So, sicknesses occasionally disturb us due to the influence of our own bad karma. Now this is the formation, the situation of our physical body. So when such sicknesses come to us, worry does not help at all. When we worry about our sicknesses, we aggravate the sickness. When you stop worrying and maintain healthy mind, a strong mind, then you can suppress the sicknesses because of the mental energy. This is another advice given by the Buddha. When you are sick physically, don't allow your mind also to be sick. You can maintain healthy mind although physically you are sick. You can be cheerful, you can be happy, you can be, what you call, with smiling face, without showing your sour face. Then that mental attitude support to reduce or not to aggravate the sickness. So healthy mind is very important. Then the third point is marana dhammo mi maranang anatito ti abhinnang paccavekkhitabba. I am not free from death. No one is free from death. If there is birth, there must be death. If there is no death, there is no birth. Death is the cause of birth. Birth is the cause of death. These two are interrelated. When we are free from both, birth and death, then we will be free from everything, all the other disturbances. So one day, Buddha advised Ananda. He said, if anybody come and ask, why they suffer here in this world, you must tell them, the main cause of your suffering is birth. If there is no birth, there is nobody to suffer. So, when you stop this birth, then we stop old age, we stop sicknesses, we stop death, we stop worrying, sufferings, everything. Just because we have very strong craving for existence, for becoming again, we develop our craving and attachment, then we had to suffer birth, old age, sicknesses, death. In between, worries, miseries, disappointment, unhappiness, disturbances. The whole life is nothing but full of disappointment, full of sufferings. How many times a day that you can maintain happiness in your life. Almost every day, you are going on crying and worrying and grumbling, accusing, blaming, fighting, quarreling, arguing. All these are unpleasant situations. Even at home, amongst the parents and children, brothers and sisters, also the same situation. What about with the outsiders? So that is why we cannot find a real happiness in this life while leading a worldly life. There is no happiness. We gain some sort of emotional satisfaction occasionally. We take this as happiness. It is not happiness. Happiness we experience when there is no fear, when there are no worries, when there are no tensions and insecurity feeling in our mind. Happiness appears only at that time. By keeping all those evil forces in our mind, we cannot experience happiness. But emotional satisfaction immediately disappears. After experiencing, that satisfaction immediately turns the other way around. So, death is natural. No one is free from that. We had to prepare for that. Prepare means knowing one day definitely we had to face the death, whether we like or not. We had to train our mind face this without fear, without worries, without crying. But to face our death with hopes and confidence, that is the most important thing. When the death comes nearer to us, then we must know how to maintain hopes and confidence. That means, after my death, my life never become miserable one. My life can become better than this one, next existence. That is called hopes and confidence. Then the fear and worry disappear from the mind. After that, we can face death with cheerfulness, because we know it is only changing our passport, renewal of our passport with new photos. Then why do we worry? If not changing old clothing and going to dress a new beautiful clothes. Death and birth is exactly like that. You throw away old clothing and get a new one, better one. That is called rebirth. So it is due to ignorance. Actually, we worry. We are scared of death. Why do we worry actually? Not because of death. We are not willing to separate from our property, from our family members, from our beloved things that we like. That is why people don't like the death. Otherwise, death is not dangerous. So we have to train the mind, whether we are young or old, there is no age limit for the death. Death can come at any time. So we must be ready. When we are ready, we have no fear, we are not scared. Then death becomes very natural, very common thing. After that, the setting sun here in this country become the rising sun from another country. It's exactly like this. The evening we can see sun is setting. Sun disappeared. But the same sun appeared from another country. So the life when it departed from here exists again in another place. And that place can become miserable or pleasurable according to our way of life. That is why religion is needed here, for us to prepare for that next life, not to suffer, to have a peaceful life. Peaceful, contented, prosperous life. So religion tells us what to do for that. So we cannot prepare for the next life by earning, eating, dancing, enjoying, merrymaking. You cannot prepare anything. No doubt you can enjoy your life harmless way, respectable way. You can enjoy your life. At the same time, don't forget that there will be another life for you hereafter. You had to prepare for that. If you go there without preparing, what will happen? You had to suffer there. This you can understand very easily. In certain countries, millions of human beings are starving, dying without food. Millions of human beings are there without a piece of cloth to cover their nakedness. Not millions, billions of human beings are there today, spending their whole life without any shelter, no house. Their birth and death both take place the roadside or the pavement under the trees, just like cats and dogs. But they are used to it. That to them, that is natural way of life. But for human beings, that is not natural. This clearly shows that they have gone from here without preparing for them to lead or to live as real human beings without facing such problems. So religion tells us how to carry certain things for you to use in the next life. You know very well your money, your property, your jewelries, your valuable things, your relatives, you cannot take with you into the next life. Whatever you have done, whether they are good things or bad things, you carry with you. They follow just like your shadow. They never stop. Follow like your shadow. Then, in the next existence, whether peaceful or happy or prosperous or contented or miserable or unfortunate life take place according to the ingredient that you have taken with you when you depart from this world. So those who do not prepare later regret. If you pay attention toward the advices given by the Buddha or religious teachers, then you know what to do. How to make use of this life while we are here. At the same time, how to have better life hereafter, after our death. Both. We can learn by following a religious way of life. Then the fourth one is Sabbehi me piyehi manapehi nana bhavo vinabhavo abhinnang pachyavekkitam. We have so many things, so many people whom we like very much. We have very strong attachment towards our money or jewelries or our property or husbands or wife or children or parents or brothers and sisters. We have strong attachment. This attachment gives us some sort of emotional satisfaction. Oh, my children, my parents, my brothers, my sisters, oh, my money, my jewelry, you gain happiness. That is, it is natural. You need that happiness to lead a worldly life. That happiness is important for you. But while you are experiencing that happiness, developing your attachment towards your wife, your husband, your children, your parents, you have to think, one day we had to separate, departure. We had to depart from our beloved ones, from the things that we like so much. We had to separate. If not earlier, after our death. Now we can see husbands and wife spend very happy married life for a few years. After that, a lot of arguments, misunderstandings and quarrelings and fightings, and then decide to divorce, separate. Children. You bring them up, you pay your attention, you spend so much for them. But those children become very mischievous, never listen to parents. They run away from the parents, if not they go against the parents. Then become nuisance to them. After that they get fed up, separate. If not, halfway. Sudden death, unexpected death, either parents or children or brothers and sisters. Separate. Our valuable things, money, jewelries that we have accumulated, stolen by someone, or fire destroyed, or the flood destroyed, or swindled by others, taken away, by force come and take away. Separation. Everything that we experience by developing our attachment, definitely one day we had to separate. We cannot carry, although we depart from this world, we cannot carry anything with us. Separate. So we had to think. When we are developing our attachment towards others, we had to make up our mind. One day, separation can take place. When that departure or separation take place, we must have courage to face, train the mind to face this. Parents look after their young children. They have so much love, affection, attachment toward them. That gives them a lot of happiness. Unfortunately, sudden death or accident take place. Children die. Now parents cannot tolerate this. Because of that attachment. That is why we had to train the mind while we are fulfilling all our duties. very carefully. The one who holds the sword must use it carefully. That can slaughter others as well as protect others. The gun that man holds, he can kill so many people, at the same time he can save so many lives. So intelligence is exactly like this. It is a strong energy. We had to divert that intelligence by training that mind not to misuse, not to abuse, but to use through proper channel to serve others. So, here in this saying, the Buddha tried to teach us, if you don't like to suffer, if you don't like to see the changes and decaying and unsatisfactoriness in your life, you cannot get rid of this situation simply by worshipping to anybody or praying. But through understanding, when you develop that understanding into realization. So when you realized, then you know how to handle it. After that, worries and fear and suspicions, unsatisfactoriness, never appear in that mind. Do you know, a Muslim scholar, I think nearly 100 years ago in India, has written a poem in Urdu language. He says, if you like to see the most happiest and contented man in this world, look at that prince who is in beggar's clothing. He was referring to the Buddha. He was a prince, but he is using a piece of cloth. This is a beggar's clothing. This is not a dress. But he is the most contented and happiest human being in this world. Because he has developed his mind by analyzing, concentrating the universal nature of our existence. After that, worries never remain in that mind. Our lives full of worries. How many times a day you had to face enormous worries and disturbances because of your family, because of your husband, because of your wife, because of your job, your income and environment and your neighbors and country and the climate. Always unhappiness. A well-known philosopher has written a poem in English. He said, if I analyze my whole life, how many years I have spent by worrying and crying and fighting and quarreling and arguing and all these things. How many years I have spent for working and working and working and earning and earning. How many years I have spent for learning and learning and learning and learning. How many years I have spent old age and sufferings and sufferings and suffering. The person who lives, say, 100 years, he says, we can take only if accumulated, computerized. We can take only 1 week. Only 1 week we maintain happiness. One who lived for 100 years. The rest of the time, a person spends for various things which are unpleasant. They are done as duties, as responsibilities, but not willingly. There is no happiness. Another saying in Sanskrit language, a man who lives for 100 years, how many years he spent for sleeping? I think more than 40 years, day and night, spent for sleeping. How many years he or she spent as a child and for study? How many years that person spent as an old man, an old lady, by suffering? Cannot see, cannot hear, cannot talk, cannot walk, cannot think, and no memory, and cannot eat, cannot sleep. How many years? How many years that person spent working day and night for survival, to support others, commitments? How many years that person spent for arguing, quarreling, fighting with others? So when you divide into categories, you can understand that you won't get even 5 years. To work for your life, you have been working very hard, but you did not work for your life. You have forgotten that you have a life. You work for so many other things, for your pleasure, for your enjoyment, for your duties, for your responsibilities, for earning, but you have not contributed anything for your life. Most of your time you spend by attending to your physical body, to feed, to decorate, to beautify, but never think that I have a life to attain. Mistaken that in the body as a life. I always mention that this is a house for life to stay. You decorate the house, support the house, bathe and clean the house. But how many times a day you dirty your life? But you never clean. When little bit of dirt, you see in your body, in your face, immediately you wash and apply Dettol also. Immediately. But you dirty your life, your mind. Every time when you create, your anger, your jealousy, your grudge, your ill will, your enmity, your selfishness, you dirty your life. All those dirt remains in the life, not in the body. But you never try to cleanse them from the life. Cleanse the body. Remember, all our germs and virus and bacteria also die after our death, or after burial, or cremation. But the germs that we have developed in the mind never die after our death. Follow us. Because they are in the mind. The mental energy is responsible for the next life. So those things remain as ingredients in the mind. Your anger, your jealousy, your grudge, your ill will, your selfish, your all these things. At the same time, your kindness, your compassion, your sympathy, your all the good qualities also remain as ingredients. But how many people are there to think and analyze in this way? Always think of the physical body, or enjoyment, or earning. By disregarding that we have a life, and this life, whether we believe or not, whether we can understand or not, continue. We cannot stop it, because the energies are there. By force we cannot stop it. Then it is our duty to work for that. Without allowing that life to suffer again. If life come into existence again, we are responsible for that life. Although we do not create it, we are responsible. Now, parents cannot create children. Impossible. But they are responsible for the children. In the same manner. If we know death is not the end of our life, if existence take place again, then we must know how to handle this life without allowing this life to suffer. On the other hand, the main purpose of a religion is not to support that life to remain again and again and again, because there is no end. So every religion uses different words. We say nirvana, Hindus say moksha, and Christians and Muslims say heaven or paradise. In English, they use salvation or deliverance, liberation, of freedom. Then freedom from what? Liberation from what? Suffering. That is why we use the word salvation. What we want is not to exist again and again and again, and by feeding and feeding and feeding. No end. To see the end of it, not to suffer. Then it will become liberation or salvation. So here in this stanza, Sabbe saṅkhāra anicchāti yadā paññāya passati atha nibbindati dukkhe e samaggo visuddhiya. Those who can understand by analyzing, by knowing, by realizing all these component things that exist in this universe are subject to changes. So when the changes take place, don't worry. Make up the mind not to worry. Then you can reduce a lot of mental disturbances. Then the second one. Sabbe sankhara dukkhati yada panyaya passati atha nibbindati dukkhi esamaggo visuddhiya. The first stanza talk about the impermanency or changes. The second stanza talk about dukkha. Sabbe sankhara dukkha. All those component things are subject to dukkha. Then there are three kinds of dukkha we experience. Dukkha dukkha, viparinama dukkha, sankhara dukkha. Three kinds of dukkha. Dukkha means suffering. Suffering means unsatisfactoriness. That is the correct meaning. Unsatisfactoriness. Dukkha dukkha means the sufferings, the pain, ache that we experience physically and mentally. Mental pain and physical pain. That is only one aspect of dukkha. We call suffering. We are suffering. But there is another aspect. Viparinama dukkha. Viparinama means changes. When changes take place, we cannot tolerate. Then we develop unsatisfactoriness. That is also dukkha. When we see we are getting old, we are very weak, we cannot see, we cannot hear, we cannot talk, we cannot sleep, then these changes create frustration, unsatisfactoriness in our life. That is the second part, aspect of dukkha. Then another one is sankhara dukkha. Sankhara dukkha. During our lifetime, we create lot of karma, mostly unwholesome, very few wholesome karmas. These unwholesome karmas influence us to experience very unpleasant life. We do not know the cause. That is why we suspect charms and black magic. We do not know what sort of bad karmas we have committed earlier or during our previous life. These things also create very unpleasant situation in our life. Now let us analyze scientifically. This is theoretically or philosophically or doctrinally. Scientifically, scientists also agree. Things come into existence due to combinations of so many things. They start from atom. Atom, neutron, proton, and this ton, that ton, so many things, unknown, unseen things. Beside all these things, when you analyze one element or dust, in that dust, all these atoms and electrons, protons, all these things are there. Then turn into matters. matters or elements combine, accumulate, then there are binding factors, right? Like magnets, or the elements combine together. Binding factor is there. And the cosmic energies also support. So the element and cosmic energies are then the mental energy penetrate into this one. Then one big bundle. Four elements, mental energies, four kinds of mental energies, and cosmic energies, known and unknown. After that, what happened? In this bundle, this is a bundle, all these elements, energies, exist because of the friction. If there is no friction, this thing cannot exist. Always going on like this, friction. Friction, 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 friction. Because of this friction, then the element or the energies sometimes get imbalance. When there is imbalance, then create sicknesses, pains, sufferings, and decaying also take place because of this friction. At the beginning, they are not noticeable. After middle age, only a noticeable signs appear. Decaying, decaying, decaying. So the main cause is the friction. It is not created by God or devils or anybody. This is the nature of these elements and energies. So when they exist as a bundle, they are friction. Clashes, then create a lot of imbalance and disagreement. Then the mental energy and the element cannot agree. Element cannot agree with the mental energy. The mind wants to do something, the body cannot agree. Body wants to do something, gain something, the mind is lazy. Disagreement. All these things become the cause of dukkha, unpleasant, unsatisfactoriness, disappointment. But people do not know how to analyze these things in this way. Why? We had to face these things. When we are suffering from all these things, what we do? We go to churches or the temples or the mosque. Go and pray and pray and pray, asking. Wait until it come down from heaven. It never come down from heaven. That is why we have to cultivate. All the other religions have come down from heaven. Buddhism is just like a rocket, started from the earth, landed on the moon, gone upward. Buddhism never come down from heaven. The development, cultivation, humans become divine, cultivated up to divine level. Not from heaven, but from the earth. We develop and develop and cultivate. So, this understanding, this analytical knowledge is the most important thing. If you don't like to suffer unnecessarily, worry for unnecessary things, fight with others for unnecessary things, create enmity for nothing, all these are our weaknesses. due to lack of understanding. So if we suffer in this world, it is due to our way of life, way of thinking. So we are responsible for that. When we create the atmosphere, outsiders also contribute for that. Then we blame them. We say, you are responsible. We never say, we are responsible. So if we are ready to accept that we are also responsible for all these problems that exist in this world, then we can settle many of our problems. Because of our strong egoism, very strong egoism we have, not ready to admit our weaknesses. When others pointed out our weaknesses, we get angry. Because of that egoism. Never say thank you for pointing out my weakness. You mind your own business, we say. That is egoism. We have to reduce all these things. Try to be humble as much as possible. Try to be simple as much as possible. Then we also get the chance to reduce most of our tensions and fears and worries and disturbances. Then the third one. Sabbe dhamma anattati yada panyaya passati atha nibbindati dukkhe esa maggo visuddhiya. The first two stanzas, the Buddha used the word sankhara. All the component things are subject to impermanency and suffering, unsatisfactory. Yes. Now here he did not use the word component things, sankhar. He used another word, dhamma. Sabbe dhamma anatta. All the existing dhammas are free from atma. What is this? When we use the word dhamma, unconditioned things also included. When we say sankhara, component things, only conditioned things are included. Matters, elements, cosmic energies, all these things are conditioned things. Conditioned thing means one thing appear because of another thing. That all these are conditions. But unconditioned things are independent. A space, unconditioned. No condition, a space does not depend on another condition. Free. Nirvana is unconditioned. Not depend on certain other condition. Very carefully he used here, when we use the Dhamma, a space, Nirvana also included. If we use Sankhara is Anatta, then space and Nirvana is not included. So we can use the word Dhamma for everything